cheap foreign labor to develop, make products to sell in the American market at the expense of American labor, and that's currently a very hot issue. But that is a very important thing. The interesting thing to me about that is that while we talk about the political arrangements among nations and organize such things as NATO, United Nations, ComCon, the multinational corporation goes on willy-nilly becoming not only multinational but trans-ideological as well, going behind the Iron Curtain, growing with not many inhibitions and constraints, but also without getting together with other multinational corporations to relate common goals and aspirations in a way through discussion and making some sense out of what they're doing. This is a very important phenomenon of our times. Well, I guess what I'm saying then is that in my personal conviction, not only has the Cold War come to a crashing end a long time ago, really, I think that if my assumptions have any validity at all, the parameters of stature and achievement now are such that the growth of the undeveloped nation, the role that Europe will play, the role that Japan will play, are all of very great and overriding importance to the future of the United States, and we must find our way to live in this kind of a world. This is a different world entirely than the Cold War world. It's entirely a different world.
Harry S. Ashmore, president of the center, begins the discussion with a question.
How does the present and prospective status of arms control and disarmament look to you?
Yeah. First of all, we've made far more progress than I thought we would. Both sides continue to arm, presumably. MIRV has been deployed now by the Soviets, according to the press. And we, I guess, have deployed a multi-warhead missile as well. When I talked to Mr. Kosygin, I guess the most eloquent plea he made was, for goodness sakes, why can't we stop racing each other in arms and armament and get on with doing things about our society that needs such doing, the environment particularly. We simply got to take care of our own environment and not race endlessly on a course of killing. Personally, I think that our problems stem from this. The military establishment of this country was taught to believe that they should exploit technology to the utmost to provide the most modern and sophisticated weapon. They're all taught that the Germans won the Franco-Prussian War because of the needle gun. I remember a general saying, just remember one thing, dollars don't count. If it's technically possible, let's get it. They had a feeling that their duty compelled them to exploit new technology to the point that they were building things that were nonsense and worthless. They didn't want to be caught being responsible for not having used the latest technology. I know that it's very necessary that we bring our race to a stop. I know why it started. I know why we're where we are. But someone's got to make decisions to change this and put our national resources onto the proper priorities. And I think we can do this without very grave risk. Indeed, I would suspect that the budget could be brought from around $76 billion to around $60 anyway. Now, in the meantime, I take it from talking to the Soviets that their intentions are good. They want to find a way to stop it. And I take it that our own negotiators want to also. The really evil characters in this situation are frequently the generals and admirals who are motivated to do what they do because they've really been brought up to believe that this is what they're supposed to do. And someone like the president must talk to them and get the thing straightened out.
General, something's been bothering me when we're talking about a new foreign policy.
John Cogley, editor of the Center magazine.
I'd be interested in your notions of what you think the presiding idea of that policy would be, in the sense that, let's say that no entangling alliances was once a presiding idea.
Yes.
Or collective security was an idea. Or containment of communism was an idea. Or even make the world safer democracy was an idea. I don't know if you thought about it. Can you think of a presiding idea under which you might put all the other things?
The way our policy has been formulated up to now was to decide what the vital issues were, what was vital to the security of the United States. One was not to allow foreign troops to land in the United States, you know, for example, is a thing. Or we might decide the retention of the Hawaiian Islands under United States control was vital. And having arrived at such judgments, we then entered into treaty arrangements to protect our vital interests, such as CENFO, CETO, and so on. I'm inclined to go the same way, what should the nation's objectives be by the year 2000? And what should the intermediate objectives be by the year 1980, say? I think then we should begin to give some description to how we would get there. The rate of shrinkage of the Earth in terms of instant communications is such that what were vital, I don't think, are really so vital now. I would suppose 25 years ago, the retention of Cuba under our own control or not in the hands of a foreign power would have been cause for war, and yet we seem to live with it now. I would base my judgment on what is vital to the future of the United States in terms of the three things I've talked about before, that is the use of the nation's resources. I think that our economic relationships with people is perhaps now one of the very vital ingredients to a prospering and happy country in the next 20, 25 years. I don't think things such as the Panama Canal, and now we're talking about Mahan's influence of sea power, you know, nor the Dardanelles, nor the Suez. I don't think the loss of those are vital anymore. And yet a generation ago, we would consider these things as being vital to our national security. I don't think so. I think what is vital in the future is different than what was vital a generation ago. This is part of the changed world in which we're living.
Part of the change has to do with the obsolescence of old political units.
Robert Rosen, visiting Center Fellow.
For example, what you were talking about in the United States, the states as such don't play the dominant functional roles anymore. Same is true on the international level. Do you see any kind of political instrumentalities which can transfer political autonomy to the new regions?
You know, this in itself is a very important subject. We got to get the administration of our social problems out of the hands of the politician. I thought possibly the president might take an ex-governor and their number of good administrative ability and ask one of them to take a four-year appointment to head a particular region of the country as a substitute for an elected vice president. We have very good governors from time to time going out of office who could do this very well. It's terribly important that we not separate people from the management of these resources and dealing with these problems. To take it out of context of our society and dream of it as an IBM system is absolute disaster. You've got to get people and into it and give them a sense of participation. And I would think that in each region you'd have a committee of people from that region representing blacks, women, minorities, and there would be political representation too. What we've got to do is organize in regions and put politically competent as well as good administrators in charge of each region. And then finally within those areas we've got to do a lot better job of administering than we're now doing. Right now we're on the threshold of very serious discontent and distrust and lack of credibility in the government.
Early in your remarks, General, you pointed out that a small minority of the population of the world are using a great majority of the resources.
Sidney Holt, now speaking, is a visiting center fellow.
Yeah. And you said that will have to change, that must change,
yeah.
I think there was. I wonder why it must change. It seems to me very likely that the great powers and military strategy will be more and more directed to retaining their proportion of the consumption of the resources.
Yeah.
This may be a very pessimistic view, but I don't see exactly what forces are acting, say, on this continent that will change. In fact, I think the political forces are set as to intensify the desire to retain what has been secured for this minority of the world's population.
Yeah. I don't, think that's necessarily pessimistic. I think mine is optimistic. Mine is rather streaked with an ideology, with idealism that probably is not very practical. I'm troubled at times as I seek to find answers to some of these problems. I'm troubled by what I see in prospect. For example, the United Nations did a study about a year ago in which they predicted in 25 years we would be out without silver in the natural state and mercury would disappear and a lot of other materials would be in very short supply and we would have by then a complete recycling process for many, many things because of the severe shortages. On the other hand, through South America and Africa, you'll ask yourself, how long will these people continue with a lack of material things when they